Welcome, teams, to our RI3D robot overview. We have Piro here who's going to talk to us about our four-bar linkage system.
Hello.
Piro.
Yep. So I'm here to talk about the four-bar linkage. This is mostly what I worked on. As you can see, our robot heavily relies on this arm to move our game pieces once they are in what we call our hand. This four-bar linkage, some of the basic measurements, this is around 6 inches apart over here. That is mirrored down there at the bottom, and that is how we keep our four-bar plane parallel. The arms are around somewhere between 46 inches and 47 inches. and then the width of this was basically determined mostly last minute by just the width of the gap in the chassis. All of this is on collars and shafts, though, so it was adjustable. This is all driven now by this sim over here with a 71 gearbox and then sprockets that go from a 24 tooth sprocket to a 34 tooth sprocket. The chain ended up being a little bit loose, so we did add in a homemade
tensioner
with a PVC.
Homemade bucket. Tensioner.
Yeah.
Wonderful. And then this wasn't the original position of our sim motor to drive the forearm.
So a couple of the issues that we ran into this as we were prototyping and building were that this was originally mounted down here with a much longer chain. That chain was significantly more prone to skipping, and we also only mounted it with two bolts. With the two bolts, because of the weight of the whole arm, you can kind of see here the bolts were dragging the metal around, and then this bolt down here ended up actually shearing and popping off. this could be fixed by what we did up here with the three bolts, shortening this so the chain doesn't skip. Also just making a more robust mounting method for the motor. In addition, to keep this metal from sliding and shifting like this, you could also use thicker stock. We ended up going with the thinner 2x1 stock because that was mostly what we had on hand, but definitely probably should make something this structural out of the thicker material.
Great. What do you think we would change if we had more time? Because obviously we only have 72 hours to construct this, so that's a very large constraint on us and our build process.
Yep. So we did start this in CAD, right? And a lot of these measurements come from a basic sketch we did to see if we could reach far enough. And Krishna, if you want to run the thing. When this is fully extended, it gets to the third level quite nicely. If we had more time, though, some of these measurements, and especially in the manufacturing process, would have been more precise. And if we had more time to kind of like, maybe not so much in parallel, but in series, design this and the rest of the system, I believe we could have been able to push this back farther to actually have most of our system in the frame instead of pushed so far out.
Could you bring it down just for 1 second? Especially because in our frame, or in our starting position to be in frame perimeter, we need our hand to be tilted up 90 degrees, but we have no way of physically controlling that with a motor. We just have it flipped down at the beginning of a match by driving forward and stopping.
Yep. Yeah, we can show it right now.
Yeah, absolutely.
So this is our deployment procedure for our intake. Kind of flops down and there it is. Mm-hmm. Other things we could improve upon are encoder for the motor. Right now, this is all just based off of power. So we found a specific power level to actually be able to hold it in kind of like our high angle ranges. So here we're basically raising it to a certain point and then holding a button to keep it there. And then we also have a separate button in our controller for kind of our low angle ranges. In addition to the encoder, other things that would be useful for the programming team would be end stops. We didn't have any end stops on hands, but definitely for the low end of our range and the high end of our range, so our motor doesn't end up self-interfering with the mechanics of the whole system.
When you say low end and high end, you mean the two different scoring locations in the...
Not even necessarily. I just mean like also when you are folded up all the way, this bar ends up interfering with our hex shaft.
Indeed.
So right now the code has no way of knowing that this is the current position of the mechanics, and you can keep driving it backwards.
Which would harm the motor.
Which would harm the motor. Indeed. And the rest of the robot. So having end stops, and like end stops are basically these switches similar to almost what you'd find in a mouse, like a computer mouse. You can place them on the robot and have little linkages to click them. You could set preset heights or just at the ends so you can specify a range within code that the arm physically cannot move out of.
Great. is there anything else you'd like to tell teams about this system, how they might take this and elevate it with the extra time that they would have to work on their robots?
Yeah. So we definitely pushed the physical constraints of what we were allowed with this starting frame. Mm-hmm. This is
just 1 inch under maximum starting height, I believe.
A little bit less than 1 inch.
52 inches?
No, we're like closer.
Oh,
we're
almost 54.
This is we're almost 54. So this is somewhere between 53 and 54 inches at height. With more time, if you can somehow at the start of the match translate these pivot points much higher, you can do a lot more with the geometry of the rest of the four bar to get easier to run arms and also farther back for more packaging for your hand and everything. So I think that'd be interesting to see what teams come up with.
Great. Thank you so much, Piero.
Yeah.